Do you have shade that's caused by a building or a fence? Or ooh, maybe you have shade caused by the woods. Or maybe you have a big tree or trees that's creating shade and you're not quite sure what to do underneath it. Or maybe your shade is along the north side of your house, which doesn't get a lot of sun. We want to know, how do we garden in that and what do we plant? Well, you've been waiting for it. Today is design day. We have a great design for you today. Come along with us as we check it out. Welcome to Gardening with the Landscape Connection. I'm Michelle. Today we are going to do a design in the shade. We are going to be doing one in front of my little wooded section here because I think a lot of people have woods and they're not quite sure how to garden. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm not going to garden in those woods. Well, I am going to create a little bit of a path and I am going to put some things in the woods. I am going to garden in front of the woods. And so what I'm going to do is bring my bed out in front of these woods so that I create some beauty for me to look at and keep it, the woods separated from my property. Now my woods expand all the way down there. It is a super long tree line. And if I were to measure it out, which let's do that. All right, so to give you a little perception, this is my property line and here is a big tree line of woods that separate my property from the back property. Now, I own the property behind this as well, but my house property ends at this tree line. So there's my big red shed, there's my house, and what I want to do is beautify this area in front of this tree line. Now, I don't know that I'm going to do the whole entire tree line. I'm going to start with 30 feet, and then as the years progress, I will add to this area. Let's measure it out and see how long it actually is. Holy cow, it was exactly 300 feet. Isn't that wild? Because here is my other property stake right there. And so 300 feet it is. Now I'm certainly not gonna landscape 300 feet because I don't even wanna think about how much that's gonna cost. I'm gonna do 30 feet, which is about what I can handle. And I'm gonna do that 30 feet directly behind my house. And I'm probably gonna end up doing this over 3 years and I'm going to do one section at a time. So let's mark out our first 30 feet and go from there. I do have my orange can of inverted marking spray paint and I've got my wheel so I can go 30 feet. I already sprayed my hand too, so I'm off to a good start. So let's go ahead and get started. Now, because of the design that I'm doing, I feel like I need it to be 12 feet deep. Now, you don't have to do one that deep, but I want it that deep because I want to layer what's going on in the bed. So I will be using some of the shrubs that I talked about in our conifer shrub video. I will also be using some of the combinations from the perennial combinations video. I'm going to put two of those combinations in here as well. And then I'm going to repeat a couple things. So you'll see that as it all comes together. But first, let's measure out 12 feet, then we'll mark the bed, and then we'll go from there. Once upon a time in a land far, far away, well, actually, it's not far, far away, it's just in my backyard, there was a path that ran in between the tree line that ends my property and the tree line that starts the property of the garden center. So I'm gonna clear the path back out as I spit on myself. I'm gonna put gravel down in here to create that walkway in here. Again, I think my grandkids will think it's really super fun. And I also wanna keep the woods that way. Now, the other thing that I'm going to be doing is along this tree line, you can see in here, all of these little scrub, little volunteer nothing trees, I'm going to be pruning those out. That way I have a clear area to grow in. And also on these trees here that you can see like right here, these little lower branches right here, I'll be cutting and pruning all of those off of the trees as well. All right, for the purpose of this video, I did just kind of do a big rectangle that's 30 by 12. And I went from the edge of the tree line, so just a little bit out like where the leaves fall, where the grass starts. I came out, you can see like right there, I came out 12 feet. So this is going to be the size of the bed. Now, I don't want to garden in the woods. That's really going to be a lot of work. And for me, I don't want to have that kind of work, so I'm not doing it. Now, if that is a situation that you have, that's a video for another day. What I'm going to do to solve my problem is I am going to garden in front of the woods. Now, we're going to go take a look at the soil that's in front of the woods. One, you can see the grass is really super sparse, but also the dirt here, it is garbage. So I'm definitely going to have to do some amending to make this better soil. See, as I come along the ground here, you can see that the grass doesn't come in very well. It's really super dry. It's got a lot of roots that are coming up from all the trees in the tree line. So
What is my solution?
Well, for me, the solution is to remove the sod, and then I'm just going to drop compost in this area, maybe some topsoil as well. But if I drop topsoil and it's just from a bulk pile someplace, typically topsoil is not government regulated. So if you buy dirt from a pile of topsoil, it's just the top 2 inches of soil that's been culled off from whoever is getting dirt in your area. Then they run it through a pulverizer, and then you buy it and you bring it home and you do whatever you're going to do with it. The problem is almost all of that topsoil is going to have weed seed in it. Now, if you want dirt or topsoil that has no weed seed in it, you're going to have to buy bags, and that is big money. So I'm not doing that. So I might have to deal with some weeds getting going if I decide to mix some of that topsoil in with my compost, because compost is more expensive than topsoil, and if I want to keep my costs down, maybe that's what I want to do. But I definitely want to create more of a raised berm area here so that I can have better soil to plant in. All right, so that's what I did first. I just took a picture of the area, the 30 by 12 area, and now I'm going to design in it. The first thing I did was I actually did the design, the part that I'm going to do in the woods first. Because if I skip that part and I decide not to do it, it doesn't affect the bed that I'm going to make in front. I can do both, one or the other, or neither. It's totally my choice. Now, this next picture is of the woods. And this is where, if I'm going to do the path between the two tree lines, I'm going to be using forsythia bushes and gravel to create that backdrop in the woods. And what I want to use is the forsythia by Proven Winners in the show-off series. Now, the ones that I would do in the back grow 6x6. They grow in zone 5 through 8, and forsythias will pretty much grow in full sun or part shade or dappled shade like I'm gonna have in these woods. They're deer resistant, and anytime you see one that's totally out of control, usually that's from poor pruning practices and or poor pruning period. Now, this forsythia, it gets a really super nice size. So if I don't wanna prune it, I don't have to. But if I do want to prune it, because I want to get in there and cut out old canes, I would cut those all the way to the ground, and I would do it right after it's done flowering. Now, the one that I'm going to do in the front is called Sugar Baby. Those are going to be more up here in front of the tree line. I'm going to do 3 of them in the front. And really, these are here, one, to give me some green. I'm going to have plenty of green in the woods once it becomes spring and summer. But I want that yellow, that show in the spring, and that's why I'm planting these. Now, in the woods, I'm going to do 5 of them, and I'm going to spread them out over the 30 feet, and I'm going to space them some forward, some back, and then just totally fill this in. It'll look awesome. Remember, when you're putting your garden in, how big are things going to get? Now, I had someone comment on, if you don't put anything else in the garden, you're going to wait forever for things to get big. But after I put this garden in, I will show you guys what I do to supplement the blank spaces that you have while you're waiting for everything to grow up. I'm a real big believer on making sure you give everything enough room to grow. Now, certainly you can put things in, but then you have to move them later if you didn't give them enough room. I'm trying to avoid that. And if that's something that you want to do, go for it. There's nothing wrong with that. Personally, I just don't want to have to move anything. So I'm going to place things where they go, and then I'm going to put pots of different things in the areas that need room to grow. I do like my trusty can of paint, and I will paint circles all over my lawn. It'll grow out, it's no big deal. But I like to paint the full circle size of what something's gonna get so that I space it properly. So I'm gonna do that with where I'm gonna put my boxwoods and my outcropping and some of the bigger shrubs that are gonna go in the bed. I recommend that you do that too, because it's gonna help you visualize what it is that you're putting in. Let's go take a look at the design. So as you can see in this picture, I have removed all of the sod. Now, you can do this a couple different ways. If you want to remove all the sod, go for it. You could probably rent a sod cutter at Home Depot. They rent them and it's pretty inexpensive. You could also go get heavy cardboard and lay it down in the area where you want to have a new bed, and then just put your compost and dirt on top of it. That cardboard eventually will break down. And then if you have grass clippings, throw some green on there with it. It'll break down faster. But just know that you could do either way. Both of them are going to work. But I also put my big elements in first. So I'm going to put my outcropping in because I like outcropping, and I have 2 pieces next door, and I'm going to put them in this bed. I'm also going to add my boxwoods and my Canadian hemlock, and this is the elbow spica. Now, remember, when you do a design, be flexible. Maybe I won't be able to find one of these elbow spicas. And the other thing was, once I started doing the design, I realized that the color of this shrub was wrong. And so I pulled it out and put another boxwood in instead because I wanted that darker green color. I'm using the winter gem boxwoods. I love winter gem boxwoods because they get the size that I need them to. They're dependable, they're hardy, and I just have really good luck with them here. I have quite a few of them growing on my property. These are gonna grow 4 to 6 feet high. And in the shade, they're probably not going to get that big, maybe 3.5 to 4 feet high and wide. Probably going to take them 4 to 5 years to get that big. And if you want these manicured in that nice little ball, you can do that. I personally, in this kind of setting, will prefer to let them get kind of, I don't know, woolly looking and just more natural looking. I probably won't prune them. And I'm okay with that because I think that's going to give me the look that I want. The one thing I do find with these boxwoods is they do turn that bronzy gold color in the winter, but they are one of the first ones to turn green once spring hits. So I got all the videotaping done, and then I went back to my office to start to edit the video and realized I didn't talk about this little pretty Canadian hemlock that I put in the front of the bed called Stockman's Dwarf. This thing is so gorgeous. I love it. It has kind of a layered pattern to it, and it is a really sweet little hemlock to put in the bed. It grows in full shade or part shade, and it grows in zone 4 through 7, only getting maybe 1.5 feet up to 3 feet high. And I think to get 3 feet high, it would have to have more sun, and it is a really super slow grower, so it's going to take it a long time to get that big. It only grows 2 to 4 feet wide. It's deer resistant, and you can plant these underneath a black walnut tree. So I put this in my bed in the front, kind of by the outcropping, because I think it's going to add this great textural element into the bed. So now that I've got all the big things in, now what I'm going to do is put in a perennial combination that I showed you in the Shade Perennial Combinations by Proven Winners. And I'm going to use one of the Easy Scapes. This one's called Day and Night. Isn't that great? I love this combination. That watercolor is fabulous. I can't wait to see that in the ground. Now here's the planting schematic that you can follow with this one. It's 9 feet long and 5 feet deep. And then if you plant these right up on top of each other like this, they will all grow together like that. I'm actually going to probably use a few less than what's in this design and space them just a little bit. I think I want some better airflow back there because I already have the woods that's restricting some of that. So I want to make sure that I have good airflow, and that is important when you're planting in the shade. If you are doing really super close plantings, you still have to make sure that the air can get through there. Otherwise, you're inviting all kinds of disease, powdery mildew, and different things into the garden because your foliage doesn't have a chance to ever dry, especially if you're in a humid area. That's something to really pay attention to. The other thing I like to do whenever I'm doing a large area for landscaping is I like to break it up into quadrants. So as you can see here, I've drawn some lines on the screen and I've broken this up into thirds. So we're going to do the right half first. And in this one, I have done the day and night perennial combination, and you can see I've put them all in there. But let's talk about what's in this perennial combination and how awesome this is going to look once I put it in. I am going to use the Hosta Coast to Coast because I want that chartreuse color. So remember, when I'm designing, I want to try and get my four colors in: red, yellow, blue, green. And this will give me my yellow element. So this is Coast to Coast. It's going to get 2 feet 6 inches high by about 36 inches wide. I do have this set more in the back of the bed, so it's probably not going to get a lot of sun, but this is a hosta that can take more morning sun. And the more morning sun it gets, the more yellow the leaves become and the brighter it becomes. So if you can situate it in that kind of an environment, it really likes that. I like this one in the back because it's going to draw your eye through the bed. I like the colors of it, and I like the size of this hosta. This one gets pale violet flowers that come up over the top of the foliage, and it grows in zone 3 through 9. So that's my first layer in the back, will be this hosta. All right, and then I'm gonna bite the bullet. I'm gonna buy five. I know, five. I'm gonna buy five of Stilbe Dark Side of the Moon, and this will be an investment, and they better not die because they're expensive. But don't you love the dark foliage? Think about that dark foliage. It kind of comes out yellow, and then as it ages, it turns that dark chocolate brown. Oh, just gorgeous. And then when the flower stalk comes out, it's like this raspberry color, and then it gets this purple flower on it. I'm going to plant five of these in mass back there in front of that Coast to Coast. Now, I'm not going to plant them in a line. I'm going to stagger them back and forward, and then in between that, I'm going to put the Hookra Wildberry. This is going to be awesome. This is Stilbe, is deer resistant, and it's growing in zone 4 through 9. These guys get about 22 inches high and about 28 inches wide, so it's my next tier down in this perennial combination that I'm putting together. Here is my Heuchera Wildberry. You could sub it with another one that you like. Just make sure the colors all work together. I like this one because I like that scallop leaf on there and that electric dark purple leaf with that charcoal veining in it. These are fabulous. They are growing 14 inches high, 20 inches wide, growing in zone 4 through 9. Now, neither the hosta nor the Heuchera are deer resistant, so we're hoping that we don't have to put deer repellent on them, but the Astilbes are. So, I don't know, maybe interplanting them together will help. We'll find out. We are going to move to the middle section of the design, and this is going to be what's called combo shade number 3. That's what the Easyscape Proven Winner collection is called. If you want to look that up, order that, get that. I am going to put this one in the center of the bed because I want this to be my kind of my taller pieces in here, and this watercolor rendition, this is beautiful. And let's take a look at the layout. Now, I said that we were going to work in 10-foot sections. This is a 9x5, so it's 9 feet long and 5 feet deep, so I still have room to put some things in front of it because my bed is 12 feet deep. And I'm going to start in the back with the Goat's Beard Chantilly Lace by Proven Winners. And I know it covers up some of that forsythias back there, but when the forsythia is blooming and looking its best, that's going to be in the spring. So I don't care if there's other things that grow up higher than that and just cover a green bush. So when I'm layering, some things might disappear in the design, and that's okay too. I think this is pronounced a run kiss, but it's Goat's Beard, and this one's by Proven Winners. It is growing in zone 3 through 7. It gets about 32 inches high and 48 inches wide. So it's a fairly large plant, and it's going to get those creamy white flowers above the plant. It kind of looks like an Astilbe, but it's more drought tolerant and they're a lot bigger, and you get that movement back there with those, and that's going to create this nice white layer that's going to help me really brighten this shade area up. So I'm really liking that we're putting this one in. And then again, as we come forward with the next two plants, we're going to intermingle those together so that it's not lines. We're just going to like back and forth and weave them together. The next layer down will be Brennera. I'm going to use the Queen of Hearts from Proven Winners. I really like this one. It gets nice, big, heart-shaped leaves on it with this silver overlay. And then it's got this really thin, narrow green edging that goes throughout the whole thing. It gets these blue forget-me-not flowers in the spring, which is kind of like a bonus because you certainly don't grow this plant for the flowers. You're growing this plant all the way for foliage. And again, it's going to have that nice silver right in the middle of the bed, which is really going to help brighten it up. These guys get 18 inches high by 36 inches wide, growing in zone 3 through 8, and they are really, really reliable. I don't cut mine back in the fall. I just leave them up and then pull the tattered foliage off in the spring. If we have a really harsh winter, sometimes they die all the way back, but a lot of times when spring rolls around, they still have some of their leaves on them. These guys are also deer resistant, and if you have morning sun, they can tolerate a little bit of that, but they really are the happiest in the shade. I'm going to finish up this grouping with the Hosta Autumn Frost by Proven Winners. It gets 12 by 24, which is a smaller hosta, and it's a nice one that you can tuck in. And so when I have the Brennera planted and I zigzag it, then I'm going to insert this little hosta in there as well. Now, this has got blue in the leaves, and there's my blue element that I'm looking for. And what I really like about it is it's a medium-sized hosta. It really does have these extra large margins on them that are this beautiful yellow color, and then they turn kind of a creamy white, those edges, in the summer. This one gets pale violet flowers over the top of it, and it's really a nice, striking hosta to add to your garden. Now, one of the things that I want to do is I don't think that having more of any one thing is better than having a lot of a few things. And so I do think quantity over variety is a design principle that I like to follow. So to finish off my bed, what I'm going to be doing is pulling elements that are already in the bed forward into the bed and adding them. So I will be adding the Autumn Frost hostas kind of over to the left, and then the Brennera in the center, just to pull those down and pull those elements throughout the whole bed. I'm also going to be adding the Wildberry Heuchera, which I'll show you in the next picture. All right, by the time I get this bed in, my grass will be green, and I have added those Heuchera Wildberry all the way over to the left to tie that last piece in. Now, I also have grown this bed mostly for foliage. Now let's take a look at the bed in the winter. So if you had a mild winter or the beginning of winter, after you cleaned your bed up of the hostas and anything that you wanted to cut back, this is probably what I would leave up in the bed. I would leave up the brunnera, I would leave up the heuchera, I would leave up my shrubs, obviously. And this is kind of what my bed's going to look like. So I still have winter interest and that nice seasonal color and structure in the garden going through winter. Now, once we get a whole bunch of snow here in zone 5, or maybe you live in zone 4, and it's a lot harsher conditions, maybe you lose the heucheras and they just kind of melt away, and the same with the brunnera. Well, let's take a look at what you would have if you didn't have any of those left in the garden. See, it still looks nice. It still has winter interest. And this isn't a bed that's right up next to my house. I can see this bed out my bedroom window. That was why I scooched it over and did it directly behind the cottage garden, not behind the shed, because I want to be able to see it. And a lot of you said one of your rules was that you always look out the window to see what your garden beds look like. And that is a fabulous suggestion. So I did. I went inside, I looked out the window, and that was kind of where I found where my 30 feet were going to be, was my view out the window. What am I going to see? All right, but we're not done, because I want early spring color when I look out the window. And like right now, it's February. I do have daffodils sprouting up all over the place, and that's what I'm going to put in this bed back here. One, they'll naturalize. Two, the squirrels won't dig them up and eat them, and they're super easy to put in and grow. Now, I just got my catalog from Netherland Bulb Company, which is my wholesaler, and they have partnered with proven winners to put out these really super cool bulbs. Let's take a look. The first one that we're gonna do is called Sunny Day. It's a double flowering daffodil, and I'm gonna get these. It's got kind of a little bit of a red center in there, if you can kind of see through those petals. Aren't these fabulous? I think that these are great. They grow in zone 2 through 10. They are a mid-spring bloomer, and they get 14 to 16 inches high. So I'm gonna definitely be putting these in the bed throughout and creating clusters of them in areas where other foliage will come up and hide them. And if I do the part in the woods, I might actually stick some back there as well, so you kind of see through the woods into those, because there'll be no green leaf canopy when these are blooming. That'll be cool. Second one that I wanna do in big batches and group throughout is called Sweet Desire. This one is also a double flowering, and it kind of has more of a peachy apricot color to it. This one I really like. It's really super pretty. Mid-spring bloomer, so they'll both be blooming at the same time. Zone 2 through 10, height 12 to 14 inches. I've never grown either one of these, or in my little catalog here, but I've already placed my order for them. And what's really cool is I will be making these available for sale for you guys as well. So as we get closer and I have them in my hands, I will put these up for sale so that if you guys want to get some, I can ship them out to you in the continental United States. So pay attention. I probably won't do that until probably August is when I'll probably, or September is probably when I'll get mine. And then once I get them, I will start offering those for sale. I don't want to do it early, because what if I take your order and then I don't get them? I would be horrified if that happened. So I'm going to wait till I get these little beauties in my hand, and then we'll offer them for sale. But those are so awesome. I'm so excited to get them. All right, so this is just one design in front of the woods in kind of the dry shade situation. Hopefully this inspired you and gave you some ideas to go plant in your garden. Hopefully you found something that spoke to you and that you love, and maybe you want to add along. I also like that, you know, we're incorporating all the different things that we talked about in the 4 shade videos that we did in front of this. Now stay tuned Thursday, because I will have 2 more designs that we will go over, and then I think I might actually have a 3rd video about shade design, because there's so many situations. And so I think we're gonna do that. And then we're gonna roll right into that What Would Michelle Do series. So if you have a garden situation that you want me to talk about, what would Michelle do if this was at her house, send those to me down below in the comments so that I can start creating this really cool video. The other thing that I'm gonna start doing is, starting in March, once a month, I will be doing a Q&A to try to answer all the questions that I'm getting through the video. So that will be coming as well. And in the last, I don't know, 20 days, I have picked up so many new subscribers. I wanna say thank you guys. I appreciate it. You are helping support the channel so that we can make great videos just like this. So thank you guys so much for watching. I hope that you're inspired. Go out and get in your garden today. If you're anywhere near where I live, it's 70 degrees. I'm Michelle. Thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video. Bye, everybody.